So welcome everybody to the machine learning coffee seminar of this morning, where the coffee now unfortunately is self-service and conditions are otherwise exceptional, but glad to see so many of you here. So the speaker of today is Professor Tapio Pahikkala from University of Turku from the Department of Future Technologies, and the topic is really about fundamentals of learning and generalization. So warmly welcome, Tapio. And so about how do we run this meeting? So let's do this as closely as normal as we can. So if you haven't used Zoom in big meetings before, so some advice. So there is a chat box which you can open by clicking in the bottom of the screen, at least for me, that's in the bottom. Then if you click another button in the bottom, there is manage participants. Then you get a list of participants, and most importantly, there is a button for you in the bottom there, which says raise hand. So if you would like to present a question to the speaker, please click the raise hand button. I will see it, I will be the chairperson, and I will then let you know when it's your turn to ask the question. And when you ask a question, then please remember to unmute your microphone and enable your video if that is possible. You understand if not, but it is easier to follow the question if you enable your video. But otherwise, please mute your microphone. So if there is background noise, not all of the others get disturbed. Any quick questions on how this works? Seems to be clear to everybody. And we are recording this session as normally, but completely digitally now. So it will be available later. So Tapio, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much for this opportunity. And I'm very eager to talk about this very new topic of ours, in which we noticed that coding theory actually provides very nice tools for analyzing the combinatorics of cross-validation. And I show some examples about this to you. So in this presentation, the playground is binary classification, as you most probably very well know. The data is expected to be split into two classes. And one of the classical tools for checking whether a single fixed prediction function can distinguish these two classes from each other is the Wilcoxon-Mann-Whitney U statistic and tests of the statistical significance of this, whether the classes can be distinguished. Then some preliminaries about the notation I'm going to use. So when I talk about constant weight words, I'm referring to binary vectors that are of length n and weight w. And weight w here means the number of ones in this binary vector. So there are w ones and n minus w zeros. And there is the as an example, the set of constant weight words of length 4 and weight 2. So this set consists of these six possible binary sequences. Then when I talk about index sets or data in general, I'm just referring to a subset of natural numbers. You can think this just as the row numbers of your data matrix. So if you deal with your data, you just use natural numbers, sets of natural numbers to select certain rows of your data matrix, and that's it. So when I talk about data used to measure the prediction performance or train machine learning models, they are subsets of natural numbers that are labeled with constant weight words. That's actually quite as simple as it can get. Then About the Wilcoxon's Mann-Whitney U statistic, this is, as many of you may know, it's the in machine learning community usually referred to as the area under receiver operating characteristics curve, AUC. So here when I use the letter U, it's actually one minus the AUC, and this U is then the for a fixed function, fixed prediction function f, it is the number or the proportion of the pairwise mistakes the prediction function makes when it compares one data point labeled with one and another data point labeled with zero. So if the value of this function f for the datum labeled with one is smaller than its value for a data point labeled with zero, then that's considered as a pairwise mistake. And this statistic is just the goes over every possible pair of data points that are labeled with one and zero. So that's usually referred to the Mann-Whitney form of this statistic. This is quite well known in the literature, I think. So this is the starting point. And then the Wilcoxon's Mann-Whitney test statistic, test of statistical significance, it can be interpreted as a permutation test of the class labels. So the null hypothesis is that we have actually drawn the class labels from the uniform distribution over the constant weight words of length and weight w. And we say that the fixed function f can distinguish these two classes from each other if the probability of drawing the true labeling of the data is smaller than some significance threshold. If we consider that it under the null, it's randomly drawn from this S. So that's the permutation test interpretation of the Mann-Whitney U tests. And here I have actually drawn the Wilcoxon's distribution over the constant weight words. So if actually this distribution is very well known, so I wouldn't have to sample it, but here I have sampled 10,000 different constant weight words, and then I have computed the value of the U statistic over this empirically sampled distribution. And then this red line determines the significance level 0.05 in this case. And it indicates that 5% of the probability mass of this distribution is on the left side of this red line. And the rest of the mass is on the right side. So if the true labeling gives a U value that is smaller than this red line, then we can say that this prediction function F makes so few mistakes that we can actually abandon the null hypothesis. That's how the Wilcoxon's test works. And then we get to the machine learning algorithms. So I use here the same idea that the machine learning algorithms deal only with labeled index numbers. And actually all the feature representations, all prior assumptions, everything we just hide under the hood of the machine learning algorithms. It's the business of the learning algorithm to decide which feature representation it assigns to each data point. So if your data matrix consists of the of a sample which is arranged, for example, in the order of observation, we have observed one at a time all the data points. We can formulate every possible learning algorithm in this way. So they take as a training set just a set of labeled index numbers, and then they do whatever they like with them. They assign feature representations or whatever to them, and then they infer a fixed prediction function, a function from natural numbers to real value. So that's the playground of learning algorithms I'm going to use here. And then to the cross-validation. Here we use the so-called leaper out cross-validation for AUC estimation or to replace the Wilcoxon's Mann-Whitney statistics for fixed function so that it's actually a statistic of learning algorithms instead of fixed functions. And instead okay, let's put it this way. It's very analogous to the ordinary Mann-Whitney statistic, except that here, while we go through every possible pair of data points that are labeled with zeros and ones, we use prediction functions that are trained with the whole sample except for this pair of data points which are evaluated during this round of the cross-validation. So for the ith and jth data points, if data point I is labeled with 1 and j is labeled with 0, then for this particular pair we evaluate it by using only that pair as a test set and everything else as a training set. And we have actually studied this Lieber-Raud cross-validation in the past, and also other research groups are studied it, and it has been shown in many studies as a very reliable way of estimating AUC for learning algorithms. It's very, as you see, it's analogous to the Wilcoxon's test. It goes through every possible pair, but it does it in the cross-validation sense. And then the main question here in this talk is that can we use the Lieber-Raud cross-validation A estimates in a similar way to the Wilcoxon's Mann-Whitney's U tests. So this cross-validation is of course an unbiased statistic for estimating the classification performance of prediction functions trained with data samples that have n minus 2 data points, of which w minus 1 are labeled with 1. But unlike the Wilcoxon's Mann-Whitney tests, null distribution, the distribution for this cross-validation is not known. And it depends on the learning algorithm, it depends on the data, it depends on so many things here that it's a difficult problem to really estimate it. And as an example, I show you one very simple learning algorithm for a start. I call it order direction learner. It just checks whether the class labels are directly or inversely correlated with a single feature one assigns for the data. One can actually even use a row of the data matrix as the feature if one likes. It's very simple to test with that. So there's just one feature, and this algorithm infers from the sample whether it's directly or inversely correlated with the class labels. And the null distribution, if we randomly draw a constant weight word as the label of this sample, it looks like this. This is not. This has nothing to do with the nice bell-shaped distribution we had for the Wilcoxon test. If one thinks about it, it makes sense, but it took some time to actually think what's going on here. But this is just a single example of how this distribution behaves with a certain very simple learning algorithm. And also this significance level 0.05, well, it's quite close to the one we had with the Wilcoxon's test, but still not in the same place, of course. And this learning algorithm is actually not so far-fetched, because we have a very similar case if we use any linear learning algorithm with just a single feature. This is support vector machine. The red line is in wrong place, so don't worry about that. I didn't have time to fix that. But this is how support vector machine behaves with a single feature. And then this is SVM with two features, with four features, with eight features. Now it actually starts to resemble more this typical bell-shaped distribution. But as you see, the variance is larger than that of the ordinary Wilcoxon's distribution. This is the distribution for the nearest neighbors method. Nearest neighbor, as you know, is a universal learning algorithm. It can learn any concepts arbitrarily well if the sample is large enough and representative enough. And it's also very, very close to this SVM with a larger number of features. So we get very different distributions for different algorithms and also different data samples. Okay, then we switch briefly to the coding theory concepts again. So when I talk about constant weight codes, I mean a subset of the possible constant weight words, such that the humming distance between all code words is at least 4. This 4 is it could be something else too, but in this presentation I always use the humming distance 4. And then one of the fundamental questions in coding theory is to find the maximal sizes of these constant weight codes. They are used for error correction and error detection, as I will show you soon. This finding the maximal size of constant weight code is one of the classical NP hard problems. So we don't have polynomial algorithms for finding them. A convenient way to illustrate constant weight words and constant weight codes is via the so-called Johnson's graphs. So here we have every possible constant weight word of length 4 and weight 2 as the vertices of this graph, and there are edges between two vertices if the humming distance between the words is smaller than 4. So for example, between the words 0011 and the word 1100, there is no edge because the humming distance is 4. And we can do this kind of graph for any kinds of constant weight words. And then a subset of words, of these words, is a constant weight code if exists an orientation of the Johnson graph under which the out degrees of the words involved in the code are zero. So as you see, I have drawn here an orientation of the graph such that the there are two vertices which only have incoming arcs, and those are selected as the code words in a constant weight code. The maximal size constant weight code in this case is just two, because it's not possible to have more code words that would have only incoming arcs. And then back to the learning algorithms. I here define a concept of leaper out equivalence. So I say that two learning algorithms are leaper out equivalents for a certain fixed index set if they have exactly the same leaper out outcomes for every possible constant weight labeling of that particular index set, just that have w1s and n minus w0. So if we even if we change completely the labeling of the data sample, but the two algorithms still give the same result on that sample, we say that they are leaper out equivalents. We consider those as the one and the same learning algorithm. And then this is one of the main observations here we made. There is a bijection between the set of orientations of a Johnson graph and the set of the leaper out equivalence classes of algorithms. So this means that every learning algorithm can be considered from the perspective of leaper out cross-validation as an orientation of the Johnson graph. And in this orientation, if I slightly go back, it makes sense, because if we here we can think every leaper out round as a single edge of on this graph. So for example, if we take this code word here 0011, and if we leave out the two middle bits 0 and 1 from the sample, and if this inferred prediction function gets it right, then it must get the get it wrong with the word that has those two bits switched. Because if we switch the two bits of the test set, one prediction function inferred from the same sample gets it right, and then in the switch case it gets it wrong. So it's not possible to get all leaper out rounds correctly if we switch the bits on the test set only, because of course the learning algorithm sees only the same training set. And back to the main question. So I have listed here a few interesting special cases. So if the learning algorithm is stable, which here means that leaving out two data points does not change the inferred prediction function in any way, then the u-value distribution, of course, corresponds to the Wilcoxon's u-distribution. So then it works like a single fixed function. There is not really too much learning taking place in that sense. However, if we draw a random orientation of the Johnson graph, then as I will show, then the u-value distribution actually has quite low variance. But then we also have this interesting useful learning algorithms that is the main topic of this presentation. But I'll show quickly those U distribution examples. So again, this is the Wilcoxon's distribution. So if the learning algorithm is stable, it behaves exactly like this. But if we take a random learning algorithm, then it looks like this. So this distribution becomes very, very narrow. This is actually very nice. Most of the learning algorithms behave like this. But of course, most of the possible learning algorithms are completely useless. So we don't really have any use for this result, unfortunately. And then how can we perform a similar test with Lieber outcross validation as the Wilcoxon's test? We could do it brute force way. We could just sample tens of thousands of labelings and do it in the hard way, but that's very expensive. And that's why I studied these coding theoretic concepts to have a shortcut for this. And then as a corollary of this proposition of having a bijection between Johnson graph orientations and the equivalence classes of learning algorithms, we see that the maximum number of different label sequences of length n and weight w for which there exists a learning algorithm that makes no Lieber out errors is the same as the maximal size constant wet code. So this now directly follows from this bijection. Unfortunately, since this corollary covers only the constant weight codes, we only see the result for u values of exactly zero. So the Lieber outcross validation makes no mistakes. But if we want to do some statistical tests, we also need to consider the cases in which we have more than zero Lieber out errors. And that's why we introduced this concept of W-light code. This W-light comes from the graph theory. There is a recent paper by Asahiro et al. which introduced this concept for the graph theory. And in graph theory, vertex is W-light if the number of outgoing arcs is at most W. And we have a similar results as with the constant weight codes, that the maximum number of different label sequences of length n and weight w for which there exists a learning algorithm that makes at most capital W Lieber out cross validation errors is the maximal size W light code. And here I actually have drawn a typical example of W-light code. It means that every code word here has at most one outgoing arc. And there is, in this case of binary sequences of length 4 and weight 2, there is the maximal number of such words is 4. As you see, there goes a cycle between these four words. And then the uppermost and lowermost word are only have outgoing edges. So it's possible to have it of size 4. And then some new results we had for these W-light codes. It turns out that we can calculate their exact sizes for these trivial cases. So if the weight is 1, or n minus 1, or if the weight is 2 or n minus 2, then we can calculate the maximal sizes of constant weight codes of W lights exactly. Then we have extended two of the classical coding theory results that are so far made only for the constant weight codes. So then we have upper bounds for the maximal sizes, and we have lower bounds for the maximal sizes. Those are results made long time ago, but now we extended them. We proved them for the W light codes, and they work in quite analogous way. And then back to the statistical tests. So here is a table of critical values for the Wilcoxon's one Whitney test. So the x-axis and y-axis refer to the numbers of data points labeled with one and data points labeled with zero. And the numbers in the table refer to how many pairwise mistakes can be made before. So that if we want to claim that the fixed function can distinguish the two classes from each other. Then we went through a couple of learning algorithms, and we empirically filled this table. We sampled the constant weight words and trends, nearest neighbors, SVMs, random forests, neural networks, and so on. And then we talked the lower bounds of the empirical p-values we found from there, and we got this kind of table. As you saw, it's not too much worse table compared to the Wilcoxon's test, just a slightly smaller number. So if we use this kind of empirical p-values, the test would be just slightly more conservative. If we would use the bounds, the lower bounds for the maximal sizes of the W-light codes, we get far more conservative tests, unfortunately. So there are some nasty learning algorithms that behave and that corresponds to those constant weight codes, the light constant weight codes, such that behave with Lieber-Rout cross-validation like this. So unfortunately, if we have a malicious adversary that wants to sell a learning algorithm and shows that it gives you very nice Lieber-Rout cross-validation result, the malicious adversary can construct a learning algorithm in such a way that it gives gives very good. It's likely that it gives very good looking cross-validation results, even if there is no signal in the data. But if we don't have such a malicious adversary, most of the useful learning algorithms behave much better. And actually, that's everything I have here. So to summarize, there are some very nice tools the coding theory provides. We only consider the Lieber-Rout cross-validation here, but I think similar ideas can be very well done also for other types of cross-validations and performance evaluation measures and so on. So thank you for listening, and if you have some nice questions, I would be eager to answer.
Thanks, Tapio. So now, if you want to ask questions, please click the participants, manage participants button or participants button in the bottom, and then you will get a list of participants. And in the bottom of that list, you will see the button raise hand. So raise your hand, and I'll give the floor to speakers. Monday morning, hopefully not everybody is sleeping anymore. So Tapio, could you, while people are thinking, could you trying to understand better what this would mean in practice? So so now you abstracted out all the kind of learning algorithm details here. So this is kind of just a measure, so to speak, of goodness. So do you think that you would be able to derive some bounds? I suppose that's at least one possible use of these results, so that you could potentially derive some bounds on the performance on an individual algorithm given some assumptions.
Yes, I think so. It could be possible to, if one makes some prior assumptions on the type of the learning algorithm and on the distribution of the data simultaneously, then I think these bounds could be improved quite a lot. It's just that here I wanted to start from this very abstract way, just to show that actually this covers any learning algorithm without any prior. So this is just a starting point.
Sure. So what is it? Okay. So there are some other ways of measuring the performance of algorithms and that have been used for deriving the bounds. So do you already have some insights on what kinds of proofs you could potentially do with this that are not straightforward in the other approaches?
Well, at least if one compares this to the traditional learning theory concepts like the Wapnick's VC dimension, I think that this resembles quite a lot that it's just that this VC dimension was infinite for some learning algorithms, but this is not the case for this capacity of the learning algorithm with respect to the Lieber-Raud cross-validation. So yeah, there is clearly this difference that the capacity is is finite for any learning algorithms. This is what these bounds for the maximal sizes of constant weight codes. So yeah, in this sense, one could now turn these results to learning theory bounds in a similar way. I just haven't thought about that too much yet, but there is a clear resemblance in these concepts.
Does this open something or enable doing some additional work? You already showed something that is important in the coding theory field, but are you seeing more impact in that field or machine learning? I was trying to ask the questions from the machine learning standpoint now.
I don't know the coding theory too much yet. I actually learned this on the fly while studying this. So if one thinks about some codes that are allowed to have some errors, then maybe yes, but I don't know if those would be, how useful those would be. But here, I think the application here is more direct in the machine learning field, because one can now derive new statistical tests that resemble this Wilcoxon's tests. So closely. So the more immediate applications I see in statistics and machine learning at this point.
Yeah, thanks. Any other questions? I don't see any hands raised, but maybe if you haven't found the functionality, I think we only have 12 people at the moment, so maybe you can even ask directly. Just unmute. Remember to unmute yourself. Based on the list that are there, I don't think many are working on the same problem. So this was more like educational for them. So yeah, it may be hard to ask a question. Mm-hmm. So if there are no further questions, then we thank Tapio very warmly. Thanks for taking your time under special conditions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot. And we'll have a next session next Monday, the same time, chaired by Laura.